Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome home to Grace Avenue United Methodist Church. It is so good to be with you this morning. My name is Christopher Vaughn. I'm the pastor of Modern Worship here, and we are just so glad to be with you this morning. I actually want to invite you to pass the peace this morning. We're beginning a new sermon series. It's entitled Sunny Days, and one of the songs that is familiar to Sesame Street, which is what our series is built around, is a song called Who Are the People in Your Neighborhood? And so as we think about this online community that we have built, this online church that we have built, I wonder if you really know the people that you worship with every Sunday. So I invite you, as the song Who Are the People in Your Neighborhood is playing this morning, to say something in the comments section, to reach out through Facebook Messenger and build and connect with one another. Who are the people in your community? Who are the people in your church that you log on with every morning? Let's find out this morning.
In your neighborhood, say, who are the people in your neighborhood? The people that you meet each day.
I hope you've taken the chance to say hello to someone in the comments, to reach out to someone that you usually see so you know who you're worshiping with. My name is Sarah Roseboom. I'm the youth minister here at Grace Avenue. It's wonderful to be in worship with you. I've got just a couple of announcements for you this morning. The first is a reminder, as you are saying hello to people in the comments section, please remember to register your attendance at the link in the comments so that we know that you are here. If you have anything you want to share with us, any joys or concerns or prayer requests, you can do that. We just want to know that you were here. If you're a first-time guest worshiping with us this morning, we are so glad that you are worshiping with us here at Grace Avenue. Guests can fill out the Connect Card link to help us connect with you and get to know you more and connect you more with the life of the church. I've got just a couple of things going on this summer that I want to tell you about. The first is that we are taking summer donations for two different events and things that are happening in the life of our church that are serving children this summer. The first is that our VBC, our Vacation Bible Camp, has an Amazon wish list. You can go to the church website and find that and donate items so that they can have those for VBC later this summer. The second is our summer lunch program. All summer we're going to be serving Preston on the Lake students who rely on school lunches to have food. We're going to be meeting that need through the summer, and we can use donations of almost any kind, especially fruit cups, pudding cups, cookies, pretzels. All the food needs to be individually wrapped servings, but you can bring any food donations to our Grace on the Go trailer in the Circle Drive all summer as we are meeting that need at Preston on the Lakes. The second opportunity to serve this summer is at a new ministry that has started called Silverlink. Silverlink is a ministry that came out of our Common Good Sign program, laity from our church are going to different assisted living communities to offer worship services. So we serve at Mustang Creek and at the Landing Assisted Living. On Sundays, we bring worship services to residents there. So we serve at Mustang Creek at 1 p.m. and the Landing at 3:15 p.m. on Sundays. So if you have a gift or a calling on your heart to be a caring presence for residents, to read scripture, to bring a devotional, to lead music, you can serve with our Silverlink ministry. There's more information on the church website on how to do that. We hope that through these and other opportunities to serve this summer, we can reach out to our neighbors all around us and serve them this summer. Now we come to the time in our service where we light our Christ candle. We light this candle every week as a reminder of the love of Christ that is with us as we worship and the Holy Spirit that connects us. If you have a candle with you in your worship space at home, you can light it as a reminder that even across the distances, we are all connected. And as another reminder of who we are and what we stand for in this community, I invite you now to join me in reading our modern community values. Here in Modern at Grace Avenue, we gather as a unified community from all walks of life. Without exception, we belong. We affirm and embrace people from every race, ethnicity, age, economic status, marital status, gender or sexual identity, ability or faith background, because all people reflect the face of God. Without exception, we belong. We seek to embody God's grace and justice in our community and in our world, and we recognize that historically the church hasn't always done that. Part of our work together is to help right some of those wrongs. Without exception, we belong. In this space, we bring our full selves. We engage our minds, we struggle with our doubts, we cultivate sustainability, and we carry one another's burdens. Without exception, we belong. Let's continue in worship together.
On and on.
Modern Family, we are really excited this morning because we are going to get to do something that we have not gotten to do in a really long time. And that is, this morning we're going to commission our youth, our students, to go on a mission trip right here in Frisco, Texas. We were really excited to have some of them with us this morning. And so as Sarah tells us a little bit more about what that mission experience is going to be and the students and adults that are involved, I want to invite all of those who are participating in the youth mission experience this week to come forward.
So near the end of this week, we have about 45 students, adults, and college students from Grace Avenue that are going to be serving in our local community. There are projects and needs in our area, and these students and college kids and adults have committed to serving their neighbors and spending their time out in the heat, spending their summer days, helping in whatever way God has called them this week. We're also going to be joined by about 15 students and adults from Grace Chapel, so we'll be serving from Frisco all the way to Salina. So we just ask for your prayers and your thoughts for them as they have answered the call to serve, and as they serve their own neighbors right here in our own backyard in Frisco.
So we are so excited as we talk about who are the people in your neighborhood that our students and our adults from our church and from Grace Chapel are actually going into the neighborhood to meet the people who live in our community and to make connections and fellowship with them. So as we prepare to send them out into the world, let us pray. Dear God, we are so grateful for these students and for these adults who are giving of their time to go and meet the people in our neighborhood, to go and meet people who are in need and to make connections and fellowship and to share your light and your love with all that they meet in our community. We ask that you bless the work that they are going to do, both the physical labor, but also the ministry of talking, the ministry of connection, and the ministry of making sure that everybody knows your love and your grace. We ask that you bless this group, that you bless those who are not present here with us this morning as well, and that you be in and through all that they do this week. Amen. And now, church, we are going to commission them to go out into the world together. And so there's going to be a liturgy on the screen. I invite you in your homes, or if you're present here with us this morning, to read it with me. We recognize you as ambassadors of Grace Avenue United Methodist Church in ministry with the local community, and we commission you to serve in the name of Jesus Christ. Through our prayers, we will be united with you in your work, and may God richly bless your labors. Amen.
Worship this morning. Sing this with me. Sing, God, I look to you.
God, I look to you. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. God, I look to you. You're where my help comes from. Give me know just what to do, yeah. God, I look. God, I look to you. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like God, I look to you. You're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom. You know just what to do, yeah. I will love you. I will love you, Lord.
Our scripture this morning comes from the book of 1 John, chapter 1, verses 5 through 7. This is the message that we have heard from God and announced to you. God is light, and there is no darkness in God at all. If we claim we have fellowship with God and live in the darkness, we are lying and do not act truthfully. But if we live in the light, in the same way as God is in the light, we have fellowship with each other, and the blood of Jesus, God's Son, cleanses us from every sin. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Well, good morning again, everyone. If you are just joining us, then you may be realizing that we're in the midst of a new sermon series. And it's called Sunny Days, and we are building it around Sesame Street. It's a really fun way to kick off the summer, and it seems really apt as we begin to look forward to brighter times, both literally and figuratively, during the summertime. But we have to wonder, right, is this a fleeting wish or a faithful hope? And so in this new sermon series, we are going to study the New Testament letter of 1 John, which begins to reveal to us a picture of what it looks like to live in the light of Christ. And along the way, we're going to have some fun and adventure as we reflect on the transformational children's program, Sesame Street. During this time, during this series, we're also going to have some fun in worship as we celebrate in future weeks our Youth Mission Week, Father's Day, and at the end of the month, Vacation Bible Camp. And as we watched those songs of Sesame Street through the years, the theme song of Sesame Street through the years, I was taken by the way in which the song has changed, the background scenery has changed. And some in significant ways. I don't know if some of you noticed this morning in the background of some of those songs was the Twin Towers. And as Sesame Street has evolved and changed over the years, as the music has changed slightly over the years, what has always stayed the same is the core message. It's a message of inclusivity. It's a message of diversity. It's a message of compassion. It's a message of caring and of kindness. And it's something that was built in such a way that all could hear it and see it and understand and hopefully be transformed by it. And so I think it's especially apt that we end up in 1 John today, because that's essentially the message of 1 John, that we would hear the powerful words of Christ, that we would live in fellowship with one another, in fellowship with God, and then in doing so, we would become kinder, more compassionate, more caring. Because in being with one another, we would lift each other up. And so as we prepare our hearts and minds for the message this morning, let us pray together. Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Fellowship. Fellowship is a word that actually gets tossed around a lot in Christian circles. For many, it's a euphemism for cookies and punch, following church, or part of the acronym for youth group, right? United Methodist Youth Fellowship. But the biblical term means so much more. True fellowship or community means that which is shared in common. The moment we trust in Christ, we become God's children, brothers and sisters in an eternal family, and we share an eternal connection with God and with one another, a profound oneness, and an exciting partnership in the gospel. We call it fellowship. And that's one of the core messages of 1 John that Sarah read for us today. When we have fellowship with one another and we have fellowship with God, then we begin to live in such a way that we have the power to change the world. This letter was written to establish an assurance of faith, to share the good news of Christ, and to help encourage all of us as believers. And to a certain extent, the writer of 1 John is saying, if we have fellowship with God, but we still walk in the darkness, then we lie. As Christians, what we say should correspond to what we do. Our mindset and our moral orientation should correspond as well. If we do not walk the walk, we cannot talk the talk. We cannot live the way that we're being called to live. I think the makers of Sesame Street walked the walk. I think they talked the talk, and I love the stories behind how they did what they did. You may or may not be familiar with Newton Minow, but Newton Minow was the appointed chairman of the FCC in the spring of 1961. And he was preparing to give a keynote speech to the annual convention of the National Association of Broadcasters. Newton had realized that children were spending more and more of their time with television, even more time with television than they were spending in school. And so he felt that TV was really not living up to its potential for kids. It had been said that there were three great influences on children: the home, the school, and the church. But now a fourth great influence was being born: television. And indeed, the speed by which television began to transform America was pretty amazing. In 1946, there were only about 8,000 homes in the U.S. that had a television set. But 15 years later, in 1961, when Newton was appointed, that number had surged to 47 million, accounting for 90% of all U.S. homes. Nowadays, we have over 250 million, accounting for about 99% of U.S. homes. Back then, the average American was watching 6 hours of TV a day. And so this was the landscape in which Newton Minow found himself. And he really wanted TV to be better. And so in his speech, he said, at its worst, TV is a procession of game shows, formula comedies about totally unbelievable families, blood and thunder, mayhem, violence, sadism, murder, Western bad men, Western good men, privatized gangsters, more violence, and cartoons. Minow then added this plea: is there no room on television to teach, to inform, to uplift, to stretch, to enlarge the capacities of our children? Is there no room for programs deepening their understanding of children in other lands? Is there no room for a children's news show explaining something to them about the world at their level of understanding? And so he said, we have to do something more with TV than this vast wasteland that has become. And so Newton Minow fell into notoriety with executives of TV shows. So much so that when the makers of Gilligan's Island began to put their show together, they named the ship in which the show would crash the SS Minow, to show Newton Minow just what they thought of him and his words. TV is a vast wasteland. And so into this vast wasteland, into this dream of Newton Minow and others, Sesame Street was born. But it wasn't alone. It was born alongside Mr. Rogers and Schoolhouse Rock, and it began a period in television that would begin to change and shape the world for the next few decades. Minow was a part of that because he dreamed of a world that was better than he found it. Instead of living into the pessimism of his time, he dreamed of something greater. Instead of just doing what had always been done, he dreamed of something new and unique and different. It's really hard to quantify just how impactful television has become to our cultural identity. When I was growing up, we didn't have cable. That meant that we had major news networks like NBC and ABC and CBS and a lot of channels in Spanish, and we had PBS. I remember for a while my grandparents moved in with us and they brought their satellite dish with them. And so for a little over a year, we had Nickelodeon and Cartoon Network, and I remember being really sad when they moved out because I was going to miss them, but I think I was going to miss their satellite dish a little bit more. But for the most part, growing up in my house, we had just basic channels. And that means I grew up on what shows were available. And so we watched a lot of Sesame Street, and I loved all of the characters from the grouchy Oscar to the sweet innocence and compassion of Big Bird. These Muffets would come alive for me on PBS every morning, and the familiar theme song that we heard today would echo through our living room. And I've been looking back on my childhood a lot. I never carried around a teddy bear like a lot of kids did. I had a stuffed Big Bird that I carried with me everywhere. There was something about Big Bird that I was drawn to. I don't know if it was his innocence. I don't know if it was his curiosity. I don't know if it was compassion or caring or whatever it was, but I felt comfortable with Big Bird. And as I think about that, as I look back on Sesame Street, what I am very taken with is this idea that they built into the set of the stoop. The stoop in Sesame Street is very familiar to most of us. It's that brown stone building with the stairs coming down of it and the green doors. And the stoop is where everybody in Sesame Street gathered. And as they gathered, if new people came in, Big Bird was always the very first one to greet the new person coming in, and then to introduce them to everyone else. And most often, they would be gathered on the stoop. And so I began to think about the gathering places in our lives, the places where we gather to meet people, the places that are the stoops in our community. The church is one. School is still another. Our workplaces. But they don't have the same feel as Sesame Street. And so I wonder, did you have a gathering place growing up? Did you have a place where you and your friends just went that felt really safe for you? A place where you could go and you could talk about anything, where you could really discuss the things that were going on in your life or the things that were troubling you about the world? A place that was just safe. You see, for me, I had two safe places growing up. One was my church. But the other place was my own living room. My parents created a place, one of those homes where you could just go anytime, where the door would be open, where there would always be hospitality, where everyone would be greeted, and where there was always enough food in the fridge. And so they created this safe place where we could talk and we could hang out and we could discuss. It was very similar to me to the stoop on Sesame Street. And I've been thinking a lot about that. Because as an adult, finding those stoops, those places of welcome, those places of connection is really hard. I have not found a place in my adult life where I have a place to gather with friends, a place to feel connected, and a place where we talk about what's going on in our lives and in the world around us. And I begin to think a lot about this, especially in regards to the Gospels. You see, one of the things that Jesus teaches us over and over and over again, and one of the things that we see picked up by shows like Sesame Street, is the compassion that we're supposed to have for each other. And he does it in profound and powerful ways. When Jesus is approached and he says, "Teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" He says, "Well, what do you think?" And the lawyer responds, "Well, you should love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul, and you should love your neighbor as yourself." And Jesus says, "Well, go and do that." But wanting clarification, they then ask, "Well, but teacher, who is my neighbor?" And Jesus tells us this powerful story of the Good Samaritan. And in the story of the Good Samaritan, the people that we think are going to be the good, righteous, kind, caring, compassionate people aren't. It's the people that we don't expect, this person that we don't expect, this person who was outcast and called terrible names and would never be considered to be somebody who would do good, who is the one that does good. And so Jesus tries to teach us something about neighbor in that. Over and over again in Scripture, Jesus tries to teach us who is our neighbor. And then he really asks us, do you know your neighbor? And we use the word neighbor in the church context a lot like we use the word fellowship. We use it to mean everybody we encounter. Our neighbor should be everybody we encounter. But do we mean it? Carol Spiney is the one who plays Big Bird. And he tells this story of one day deciding instead to ride his bike to the set of Sesame Street, he decided to walk. And as he was walking, he saw an old man standing on the curb. He wasn't dressed very well, and he thought, okay, well, this is just another one of New York's drunk and homeless. And it was kind of raining, and so he walked past the man, and the man didn't say anything to him, and he crossed the street, and then he looked back, and there was this expression on the man's face. And Carol said, you know what? Maybe he actually needs help. I'm just going to go talk to him. And he went back and he approached the man and he said, do you need help? And the man said, I'm just afraid. I'm old and I live alone, and if I step off this curb and I fall and I break a hip, there's not going to be anybody to take care of me. And immediately Carol was taken by guilt and shame, because his first instinct had been to walk away. And so he began to be filled with compassion for this man, and he grabbed him by the arm and he helped him to cross the street. The man thanked him. And as he continued his walk towards Sesame Street, he began to think about that. And he began to think about, you know, what we really need to be teaching the children on Sesame Street is compassion. And so immediately when he got back to the building, he went to see one of the producers and he told them about his story and how about he felt like we really needed to be teaching children about compassion. And they said, well, Carol, that's great, but how are you going to do that? How do you teach something as abstract as compassion to children? And Carol was left speechless. He really didn't know. And so as he walked away, he was feeling a little discouraged, and he just decided that, you know what? What I'm going to try to do is I'm just going to try to imbue the character of Big Bird with compassion in all situations. Many, many, many years later, an article came out that was describing the different characters on The Muppet Show, from the enthusiastic Elmo to the Grouch or the Heart of Gold. And at the very end, it said, and the ever-compassionate Big Bird. And Carol said, that was one of the greatest achievements of my life, that the compassion that I wanted to shine through did. This is our calling in 1 John, when we're being called to fellowship with one another, when we're being called to fellowship with God and in light, driving out the darkness. It is in living our lives with compassion and care and kindness that we begin to truly live into what it is Christ is calling us to do. Who are your neighbors? Your actual neighbors. Like when we passed the piece this morning and we sang the song, who are the people in your neighborhood? Do you know them? My son Benjamin is the welcomer in our family. It's an official title that he has earned. He just loves people. He always has. And I often joke that if you were to put googly eyes and a smile on a brick wall, he would talk to it. During most of the last year, he's been really isolated. He's been away from people because of the pandemic. And I will never forget the first time several months ago that I took him to Walmart. He hadn't been to any stores or anything throughout the pandemic, and I took him to Walmart, and I really felt like it was a mistake the moment that we stepped foot in the parking lot. Because as soon as we stepped foot in the parking lot, Benjamin started talking to people. He said, hi, how are you today? And people would be a little startled, and some would say, well, I'm doing okay, how are you? And some would walk past, and he thought anybody that walked past was very rude. And I had to tell him, well, buddy, we're still in the midst of a global pandemic. Not everybody's comfortable just stopping and talking to others. And he said, well, that's just a shame, because I really want to get to know them. Benjamin is the welcomer in our family. And television really does have an impact. I've told this story many times, but I find it especially relevant today. But 2 years ago, Benjamin was watching an episode of Daniel Tiger. Daniel Tiger, for those of you who might not know, is kind of the new version of Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. It's an animated version that features a tiger named Daniel and his family. And Daniel really wanted to get to know his neighbors. And so one of the things he did was he baked cookies for his neighbors, and then he took those cookies next door to them. And so, of course, immediately what Benjamin wanted to do was bake cookies for our neighbors and take them to him. And so we helped him gather all the ingredients, and we got some cookie cutters, and he baked the cookies himself, and he iced them himself. And then he took the cookies, and while we had some hesitation, because, you know, just knocking on someone's door that you don't really know is not something that we do, he didn't. And he walked straight up to the door, and he rang the doorbell, and he met the neighbors that live on either side of us. And in the midst of that, we discovered that our next door neighbors to our right were actually members of our church here at Grace Avenue. Dave and Danielle had lived next to us for almost a year and a half, and we never knew who they were. And so when I ask that question, who are your neighbors? I do mean, who are your physical neighbors? Do you know them? Do you know the people, the names of the people who live across the street from you? The people who live next door to you? Do you know the people who live three doors down from you? But even further, do you know all of the people who work in your building? Do you know the people who sit next to you or behind you at church? Do you know your neighbors, your actual physical neighbors? Do you know your Muslim neighbors in our community? Do you know your Hindu neighbors? Do you know your Jewish neighbors? There are so many people who live in this community that we call Frisco. Do you know them? Do you have compassion for them? Do you have care for them? In 1941, we had 8,000 television sets in America. By 1961, we had almost 50 million. And so as we think about our neighbors, I also want you to think about how much can change in 15 years. I want you to think about how much can change in 15 years. Think about what can happen in such a short amount of time and how we then face the world ahead of us. Because when I think about 15 years ago, I had barely been on Facebook. 15 years ago, Facebook was still an isolated social network just for college students. And now 15 years later, it is this powerhouse that profoundly influences our lives. 15 years ago, we were just getting used to having Wikipedia, an online encyclopedia that shares knowledge for free with everyone. 15 years ago, my professors were telling me that Wikipedia was not a source material. It wasn't accurate. Anybody could change it. You just can't use it. And now we know that Wikipedia is more accurate than the Encyclopedia Britannica. You see, a lot can change in 15 years. And so I want us to really think about, as a church this morning, as we think about who are the people in our neighborhoods, who are the people that live next door to us, who are the people that are near us, who are the people God is calling us to really think about that 15 years. Because 15 years from today, what do we hope is going to happen? What do we hope is going to happen with our church? What do we hope is going to happen for our families? What do we hope is going to happen in our community? And do we want to be products of that change? Or like Newton Minow and like Carol Spiney and like Jim Henson and all of the people who helped create Sesame Street, do we want to affect that change? Because those are really our two choices. We can be products of change, or we can affect that change. Knowing who is your neighbor helps us to change the world. That's what Sesame Street did for us. It really tried to show us who our neighbors was. It showed us a neighborhood that was diverse and inclusive, and it included people from all over. And it really helped us to look and analyze the world in which we live in. It tried to show us greater compassion. Brené Brown is famous for saying, "You really need to get to know people because you can't hate people close up." We have so much division and animosity and fear in our world right now. We have fear of other. We have hate of other. We want to challenge and push back. We think that everybody agrees with us, and if they don't agree with us, then they must be the enemy. We've taken a world that should be seen in duality and made it in black and white. There's so much nuance to the world around us, and yet we want to see good and evil. We've really moved away from the essence of what Jesus was trying to teach us when he said to love your neighbor. Because to love someone is to know them. And it's really hard to hate close up. It's really hard to condemn close up. It's really hard to talk about someone to their face. And that's why Jesus told us to love one another, to care for one another. That's why Jesus told us don't gossip, but to address the people that we're frustrated with directly, because it's so hard to hate close up. What Sesame Street teaches us is that there is power in our diversity, power in our inclusivity, and there is power in gathering together. Because in gathering together, if we know who our neighbors are, we are more fully able to love them like Christ loves them. They're no longer our neighbors, this abstract thing, but they're a name. They're a person. They're somebody that we know. And we know their story, and we know a little bit about their history, and maybe we know their children, or at least we know where their children go to college. Maybe we know about their grandmother who's in the hospital. Maybe we know about the struggles that they have had with alcoholism. Maybe we know just enough about them that we can care for them. Because that's what it really means to know the people in your neighborhood. That's what Sesame Street was trying to teach us when they sing that little song and they walk around. It's so much more than an abstract concept. It's a calling to really reach out, to be connective, and to be compassionate. And that was the reminder that we read today in 1 John. It's this reminder about empathy. It's this reminder about compassion. It's this reminder about fellowship, true fellowship, which we call community, because that means that it's shared in common. And we're supposed to share that in common with one another, but also with all of those that we meet. And so this day, as we are inspired by Sesame Street, as we think about the sunny days to come this summer, I invite each of us to know the people in our neighborhood. Because if we can know the people in our neighborhood, then we move from hate and animosity into compassion. We move from not knowing to knowing. And in knowing our neighbors, then we truly know the face of God. And then we are able to, as 1 John said, drive out the darkness, because God is light, and in God there is no darkness. And in that we have fellowship with one another. So may you create a stoop in your life, a place where people can gather, where they can really get to know one another. And may you always be reaching out to invite people into that place of welcome so that you can know them and they can know you, and that through all of that, in the fellowship that we have, that they can know the God of all creation. Amen.
As we reflect on Christopher's words this morning, will you join me in a time of prayer? Dear Lord, we are thankful for community. We are thankful for this community of worship, where we come to be in fellowship with each other, to be in relationship with you, where we come to explore a bigger call on our lives. This month, as we start talking about our neighbors, as we start talking about sunnier days ahead, help us to take the words that we hear here, the lessons from the songs from Sesame Street, help us take those into our daily lives. Help us have the courage to reach out to our neighbors, our literal neighbors, the people who live near us, and everyone we consider a neighbor. The people we work with, the people we worship with, the people that we interact with every day. Help us to create authentic and real connection. Help us to be a person that others know that they can come to. Help us to shine your light in every relationship that we have. Guide us to those that you are calling us to help. Help us feel your tug on our hearts, where people need our love and your love. Help us to heed the words of Jesus in knowing that everyone is our neighbor. And help us to create those spaces where we can gather, maybe literally in person, maybe online, in whichever ways, so that we can offer authentic community and shine your light in the world. We ask all of this in your Son's name, who taught us to pray the prayer we now say together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We have come now to our time of offering, where we invite you to give to the ministries of our church as we seek to get to know our neighbors, as we seek to build a community where everybody can come and feel welcomed and know that without exception they belong, and as we prepare to go and meet our neighbors this week through the youth mission experience, through the feeding of the children at Preston on the Lakes, through the green team who will begin cleaning up trails regularly in an effort to better our community and to better our world. And so as we seek to build the kingdom of Christ through our ministry here in Frisco and beyond these walls, we ask that you give generously with your hearts so that we can do these things that we have been called to do. You can give online through the link in the comment section this morning. You can snap a picture of this QR code. We have a text to give option. There are so many ways that you can bring your offering to God this morning, and I invite you to give generously. We're now going to sing our closing song together.
There are no outsiders to your love. We are all welcome. There's grace enough. When I have wandered alone, your cross is the open door. There are no outsiders. I'm not an outsider. I was tired, I was poor, I was thrown upon your shore, I was homeless and afraid, till I heard you call my name. Now I'm ransomed, I'm restored, resurrected, I am yours. I am loved, yes, I belong, oh my soul. Your cross is the open door. There are no outsiders. I'm not an outsider, 'cause there are no outsiders to
Well, it has been great to be with you in worship today. As we go forth, let's go forward with this blessing and benediction. We ask the question this morning, who is your neighbor? Who is your neighbor? And as we think about who your neighbor is, it's the people next to you and across from you and around you, but also, as we worship online, it's the people who worship with you every Sunday. And so I encourage you to message one another, to reach out to each other, to know each other. Because in knowing one another, then we can have compassion for each other. We can care for one another. We can know each other's stories. And then we become truly neighbors. We become wrapped in this fellowship of Christ. So may we get to know our neighbors this week. May we really and truly reach out this week. And may we live into the call of Christ to have fellowship with one another. And as we go forth, may we go forth with the blessings of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And wherever life takes you this week, I hope you find your way back onto Grace Avenue. Go in peace. Amen.